From the long axis view to the short axis view. Actually, views, because there are many ways that you can cut through the short axis of the left ventricle, either more at the base or more at the apex. We'll start with the base. So if you rotate the transducer counterclockwise while you have the aorta in the center of your image, you will get to the short axis view. Now remember, you've got the three cusps. This is the right coronary, the acoronary, and the left coronary cusp. And coming off of the right coronary cusp, you have the right coronary artery right here. Sometimes it's even possible to see the ostium of the left coronary artery. In our individual here, since he's an ideal model, you can actually see it right here. Sometimes you can even see the bifurcation between the circumflex and the LAD. But now, showing you the other structures you see, this is the left atrium. If you tilt the transducer a little bit more caudal, you can see the left atrial appendage here. And if you move the transducer back, it's very nice to identify the intraatrial septum. If you turn to the right atrium and move the transducer a little bit more, focusing on the right atrium, you can also see the IVC as it enters the right atrium. Here is the tricuspid valve. This is the right ventricular outflow tract. And now moving towards the left shoulder and tilting that transducer a little bit more, we'll get to the pulmonic artery and the pulmonic valve. So this is the pulmonic artery with the branches, the right and the left. Sometimes it actually makes sense to move the transducer a little further down to move one intercostal space more caudal, and you'll get an even better view of the pulmonic artery, as you can see very nicely here. The pulmonic artery displays itself actually like an M with a coaptation between two of the cusps right here in the middle. Again, the aortic valve is in the center of the image, and the right pulmonary artery undercrosses the aortic arch, because this is the ascending aorta and this is the descending aorta, so it's going right under there. So these are the structures and these are the anatomic landmarks that you can see in a short axis view. My experience with hands-on training is that most people have problems to getting from a long axis view into a short axis view. Why is that so? Well, because they do not have a stable position of the transducer on the chest. They either move the transducer or tilt the transducer. I will show you a very important way of really being under control when you perform the short axis view. Now you start with the long axis view. We saw that in the demonstration. And while you rotate, you will see that all of a sudden the longitudinal orientation or the full length of the ascending aorta will not be visible. You will lose this right here until the aorta starts to close here. So does here also the ventricle. And when you have a view where you are able to nicely visualize the three cusps of the aorta, you're in the correct view. So be aware that you also have to keep the position stable. In other words, this angulation should not change. It should always be the same. And also try to always have the left atrium in your field of view. If you look at the classical graphics of a parasternal short axis view, it is always displayed in such a way that you have the aortic valve and the pulmonic valve nicely visible at the same time. In reality, this is not always the case. Usually you either have to focus more on the aortic valve or on the pulmonic valve. And later on, I'm going to show you a specific view how you can focus on the pulmonic valve. Now, where do we use this view? Well, there are many, many applications. The nice thing about this view is that you have an en face view of the aortic valve. This can be appreciated here in a three-dimensional image. This allows you to see all three cusps simultaneously and therefore allows you to look at the opening motion of the aortic valve and also at the degree of calcification. So very important for the assessment of aortic stenosis. In addition, if you modify the view a little bit and focus more towards the tricuspid valve, you can also look at TR. And sometimes this is the view where you'll actually get the highest TR signal to quantify pulmonary pressure. It's possible to look at the right ventricular outflow tract. So this is the view that I would use to determine whether or not obstruction is present there. I mentioned already that you have to use modified views of the parasternal short axis view frequently. And if you want to, for example, detect an ASD, it's better to move the transducer one or maybe even two intercostal spaces further down so that you almost have an apical view. And here you will have a very good orientation to the septum, which allows you to detect, for example, an atrial septal defect. As already mentioned, the short axis view is ideal to identify the individual cusp of the aortic valve. How is this done? Well, we'll take a look in the following demo. Let's take a look at the short axis view on the simulator here and see how we can actually identify the different cusps of the aortic valve. Right here, this cusp, which is close to the interatrial septum, would be the acoronary cusp. The cusp which is close to the pulmonary artery is the left coronary cusp, and the one which is close to the right ventricular outflow tract is the right coronary cusp. And once you identify this cusp, it's also easy to actually tell which coronary arteries actually leave the aortic root. Here this would be the right coronary artery, and right here is the left coronary artery. Now the right coronary artery is usually easier to identify than the left coronary artery, and it also depends, of course, on the size. What else can you see in a short axis view? Well, obviously the structures that you probably already know, the left atrium, the right ventricular outflow tract, but if you tilt a little bit back and forth, you can even see the pulmonary veins, how they enter the left atrium. Also be aware that the pulmonary artery is very close by, and very frequently you will already see the pulmonary artery in a short axis view. Sometimes, however, you will have to optimize the view, turn a little bit more to the left shoulder and tilt a little bit more, and all of a sudden you will see a very nice long axis view of the pulmonary artery and even the bifurcation between the left and the right pulmonary artery. From the parasternal short axis view, you just have to perform a small maneuver to get a better view of the pulmonic valve. So this is the modified view of the pulmonary artery and the pulmonic valve. You see that the orientation here is a little bit more oblique. You're performing a maneuver where you rotate the transducer clockwise and tilting a little bit to get more shallow so that you're closer to the pulmonic artery, which is actually closer to the chest of the patient. If you compare the two views, you will see that you can see both structures in both images, the classic parasternal short axis view at the base and the modified view. However, you will appreciate that the pulmonic artery and the pulmonic valve can be seen much better in this view. Here you can even see the right and the left pulmonic artery. So both of these views are part of a standard exam. Let's repeat some of the tricks. Position the patient so that he is in a very left lateral position. Sometimes he's almost lying on his stomach. Place the transducer more ventral and more to the left by rotating clockwise. And also let the patient sometimes exhale. This could also help you in getting good images. Here's such a beautiful view where we use color Doppler to visualize pulmonic regurgitation, a very frequent finding, as you will find out later on in this chapter. What is it good for? Well, obviously to look at the pulmonic valve to detect stenosis and regurgitation, and to look at flow. You can measure the velocity of flow across the pulmonic valve and through the outflow tract, and that helps you to quantify, for example, shunts. You can look at the right ventricular outflow tract to detect obstruction, I mentioned that already, but also to look at the size of the pulmonic artery. Here's a beautiful example of a patient who has a very wide pulmonic artery. Right down here would be the region where you would expect a patent ductus. So this view is equally important to detect this form of congenital heart disease. Now let's move on to another short axis view, to the short axis view at the level of the mitral valve. Let's image the mitral valve in a short axis plane. Make sure that you don't over-rotate the ventricle or under-rotate the ventricle. Try to have the ventricle in the center of the image. You can correct that by moving the transducer either towards the left or towards the right. The other important tip that I would like to give you is try to see that you see the anterior leaflet not discontinued, because if you do, then you are a little too far towards the apex. That's where you actually have the chordal structure inserting into the anterior leaflet. So this would be the optimal view. And here you would nicely see the mitral valve open like a fish mouth with the anterior leaflet right up here and the posterior leaflet here. Note that you can nicely appreciate the anterolateral commissure. That's where the anterior and the posterior leaflets meet close to the lateral wall, and the posterior medial commissure, which is right here. This is a very important view if you want to exactly localize, for example, a mitral valve pathology. We'll talk about that later in the chapter on mitral valve. If you want to image the mitral valve in an optimal position, it's very important that you transverse the mitral valve actually at its tips. Here is an example of what happens if you're too far caudal. Then you will only hit subvalvular apparatus. So you need to scan back and forth to find the optimal position where you really see the fish mouth of the mitral valve. What is it good for? Basically to look at the mitral valve, to look at tumors, to look at the degree of calcification, maybe also mitral annular calcification, but it's very important if you want to quantify the severity of mitral stenosis, because here you can perform planimetry of the mitral valve. In addition, you can look at the origin of mitral regurgitation. Now let's move the transducer or the cut plane further caudal, and let's look at the short axis view at the level of the ventricle. So as you heard previously, there are different levels at which you can image the ventricle. However, I would probably stay away from just imaging the standard views to a sweep where you sweep through the entire ventricle. Let me show you how this is done. We are here now at the level of the mitral valve in a short axis view, and now trying to stay perpendicular to the axis of the heart, which runs something like this. You will tilt the transducer downwards and upwards and thereby scan the entire ventricle. Let's start at the mitral valve and move downwards. You see the left ventricle is obviously a circular structure with the right ventricle right here. This is the papillary muscle. The further down you go, the more you will see the attachment of the papillary muscle with the wall. One muscle is here, here's the other one. You can nicely appreciate here the pericardium, which is the very echodense structure. Then you tilt downwards and look what happens to the size of the left ventricle. You see it gets smaller and smaller. Sometimes it makes sense to move down one intercostal space while you do this, because frequently you will get a better image quality. Let me show you this. So now you're moving down one intercostal space. The ventricle here is still round. You see the trabeculations very nicely. And if I move further down, you will first of all lose the right ventricle here, and the left ventricle gets smaller and smaller and smaller. So this is what I would perform to sweep through the entire ventricle to really appreciate the global left ventricle function and to detect regional wall motion abnormalities. Let's move to the simulator again and let's see which structures we see when we perform such a sweep. So let's see what happens when you tilt the transducer along the axis of the heart more caudally and more cranially. This is, of course, somewhere in the middle of the ventricle. Now, if you tilt the transducer further down, you will see that the left ventricle gets smaller and smaller, and so does the right ventricle, until at some point, you will actually lose the right ventricle and you will only see the supraapical region of the left ventricle. Now, in most patients, this is not possible. If you want to get the supraapical portion, you need to probably put the transducer one intercostal space further down. Another important thing to note is that you're very close to the diaphragma. You can see the diaphragma right here, and this also helps you to identify where the inferior wall is. Just as with other views, it's very important that you know how atypical or wrong views look and what maneuver you must do to get to the right view. So here is a series of images where I rotate from a position which is, I would say, over-rotated in the counterclockwise position to an over-rotation in the clockwise position. And you see what happens. Here you have an oval shape of the ventricle where the axis is more towards the left of the screen, and here the axis is more to the right of the screen. Now, when you start rotating back, you will eventually get to a view where you have a symmetrically round ventricle, and this is the view that you should try to achieve. If you, however, use a transducer position which is too far caudal, you will also get an oval shape of the ventricle, but in this case, the oval shape will be more in a longitudinal direction. So this is an image that I actually performed for Easter to artificially get Easter eggs with the help of a short axis view that is too far caudal. So here you see the shape of the ventricle looks like an egg, like an Easter egg. If you want to avoid that, which is usually good if you want to measure, you need to move the transducer simply up one intercostal space. This is just to demonstrate why we get an oval shape of the ventricle, because we're cutting through the ventricle more oblique. So the distance here will be longer than the distance would be if we really cut the ventricle perpendicular. The short axis view is ideal to look at the septum and the position of the septum. I guess all of you realize that this is not a normal echo. Here you have septal flattening in a patient who has severe pulmonary hypertension. In addition, you can assess the thickness of the myocardium, especially of the septum, but also of the right ventricle. Furthermore, the parasternal short axis view at the level of the ventricle is always good to look at pericardial effusion. Here you see a very small effusion right in the inferior part of the heart. And it's possible to look at the relationship between the right ventricle and the left ventricle. In this case, it's balanced. In other words, we have normal-sized heart. A modification of the short axis view is the short axis view at the supraapical region. Now, this is not a classic standard view that you will find in the textbook, but I want to teach you this view because, after all, you want to become a master of echocardiography. And this view will definitely help you because it will allow you to see a portion that is often very difficult to see with other views. How do you get such a view? Well, basically, by moving the transducer a little further down from the standard position, which is usually in the third, fourth intercostal space, and then just cutting only the apex of the heart. So you have the cavity, which appears very small here, obviously, because you've got a bullet or conical shape of the ventricle here. What is this view good for? It's good to look at regional wall motion abnormalities here, for example, to detect supraapical infarcts. You can look at a thrombus that might be present in this region. As a matter of fact, that's usually where a thrombus is located. And you can look at a pathology that we call non-compaction cardiomyopathy. Here you have a hypertrabeculated left ventricle, usually at the apex. It looks like a mesh here almost, a spongy myocardium, and that is often best seen in such a view. To summarize the parasternal short axis view, if we scan from top to bottom, from cranial to caudal, these are the short axis views you will get. The base with the aortic valve in the center, at the level of the mitral valve, remember, the typical fish mouth appearance of the anterior and the posterior leaflet. The left ventricle, somewhere between the subvalvular apparatus and the papillary muscle, and the view I just showed you where you're very far down at the apex. Of course, don't forget that there are many views in between and that it's advisable not only to look at the standard views, but to scan through the entire heart to see all the different portions. Good. So that basically summarizes the parasternal window, but we're not done, obviously. In the next chapters, we're going to look at another very important window, the so-called apical window.